day, Rabbi, sold I to the merchant ships. Minutes after they took I from the bottomless pit. But my hand was made strong by the hand of the Almighty. We forward in this generation triumphantly. Won't you help to sing these songs of freedom? 'Cause all I ever have, redemption songs, redemption songs. Emancipate yourselves from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. Have no fear for atomic energy, 'cause none of them can stop the time. How long shall they kill our prophets while we stand aside and look? Some say it's just
it's local, state, and federal news, and we have quite a bit going on in all three arenas. So we'll get into an active dialogue on this program about those matters. And again, I seek to inform you. I seek engagement. Many of you speak to me, you know, at the post office, at Albertsons, Walmart, in the public arena about the show, about some things, some issues that you have heard, and some opinions that you have heard, and you wish those to be expressed. So I appreciate you speaking with me and having that big community dialogue. It is very important for discourse, especially in this time, especially in this day, to have intelligent discourse and to show that we have some thinking people in this area. Not only do we have very talented people in this area, we have some very profound individuals as well who have been fighting in the struggle for social justice for many, many, many decades. So I salute you for all of your efforts. So again, local, state, and federal news. But before we get into that, we have two dedications. And before I mention the two dedications, there's a wonderful documentary entitled Sugartown, tomorrow, 729, the Discovery Channel. It's about Victor White, so you can Google Sugartown Victor White. It's a very informative documentary. As you know, Victor White is the individual who was unjustly killed. He was handcuffed, and the report went that somehow he, after being searched twice, had a weapon and used that weapon to commit suicide, and that has since been found to be credibly not realistic. So Sugartown will go into Victor White III's case and his life, and it will be a very engrossing documentary. So tomorrow evening, so Google Sugartown. It will be on the Discovery Channel, 729, the Discovery Channel. But if you Google it, you can get all the information you need on this wonderful documentary tomorrow. All right, so our first individual, a giant of United States history, not only African-American history, and that is the man that I admire for his stance and his courage, Ronald Vernie Dellums. Ron Dellums, born November 24th, 1935, and he transitioned July 30th, 2018. He was a politician and human rights activist, and he was called an agitator for justice when it wasn't popular to be one. He was called that by Cynthia McKinney, a Georgia U.S. House of Representative member. And of course, she was courageous, and she voted against the Iraq War, George W. Bush's Iraq War. And of course, she was tormented as a result of that. but she courageously took her own course and fought against injustice, and really was a politician to be admired as well. So she followed in the mold of Ron Dellums. He was one of her heroes. And let me read you a little bit about the mighty Ron Dellums. Ronald Verney Dellums was born in Oakland on November 24th, 1935, to Verney and Willa Dellums. His father was a sleeping car porter before becoming a longshoreman. He was also an organizer of the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters. So Ron Dellums had it in his blood from his father. After he graduated from high school in 1953, he joined the Marine Corps. He was discharged in 1956 and attended Laney College in Oakland on the GI Bill, and earned a bachelor's degree from San Francisco State College and a master's in social work from the University of California at Berkeley in 1962. Okay, a giant. In the 60s, Mr. Dellums worked for state and private social work agencies in the Bay Area, aiding poor and troubled clients. It was an era of an anarchic struggle against racism and police brutality in Oakland. Shootouts cost dozens of lives. Mr. Dellums disowned violence and never joined paramilitary groups that had a larger presence in society, but he defended the struggle against racism. His foray into politics, his first foray was a run for the city council seat in 1967 in Oakland. He became an advocate for minorities and liaison to student groups at Berkeley. In 1970, backed by a coalition of minorities, students, and labor, he upset Representative Jeffrey Cohelan, a more conventional liberal in a Democratic primary for the Oakland-Berkeley seat in Congress, and easily defeated a Republican in the general election. The district was redrawn twice, so it was gerrymandered, and even with gerrymandering, his margins of victory reached up to 77% of the vote. So if you're doing what's right, you're gonna retain an appeal, you're gonna retain a popular vote with the people, and you will have the conscience of the people. Mr. Dellums became a lobbyist, starting his own Washington firm after leading politics and representing clients in transportation, pharmaceuticals, and health insurance. He served one term from 2007 to 2011 as mayor of Oakland. He hired more officers to fight rising crime and added teachers and new programs to cut truancy and dropout rates in troubled public schools. So a giant. He, in the 1970s, early 1970s, while in the U.S. House of Representatives, demanded a House investigation into American war crimes in Vietnam. When his pleas were ignored, he held his own informal hearings, which drew national attention. As anti-war protests raged outside the Capitol, a former Army sergeant told in unsworn testimony how he and his platoon had massacred 30 men, women, and children in a Vietnamese village. It was a shocking beginning. Over the next 27 years, Mr. Dellum became a voice, still depending principles of the downtrodden, spearheading the Congressional Black Caucus, conferring with the White House and Pentagon and leaders of Congress as a member, and finally, as the chairman of the powerful House Armed Services Committee. After a 14-year campaign against apartheid in South Africa, working with John Kasich, a Republican, he wrote the 1986 legislation that mandated trade embargoes and divestment by American companies and citizens of holdings in South Africa. President Ronald Reagan's veto was overridden by Congress, a 20th century first in foreign policy. The sanctions were lifted in 1991 when South Africa repealed its apartheid laws. So a great individual, a humanitarian, one of my heroes. And we don't have many to this day, individuals who are willing to stand up and fight and make a difference and ultimately be the difference. So we salute you, Ronald Dellums. You certainly worked on behalf of the community and the greater community of the United States. So you are a great humanitarian and a great American. All right, so the second individual that we are honoring tonight is Henrietta Lacks. Henrietta Lacks. You may have viewed the movie that she, that Oprah Winfrey made of her story in the book, The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks by Rebecca Skloot. But the movie was nominated for several awards. But let me tell you a little bit about Miss Lacks and her great legacy. Miss Lacks was a young mother of five when she visited the Johns Hopkins Hospital ill. Upon examination, a renowned gynecologist discovered a large malignant tumor on her cervix. At the time, the Johns Hopkins Hospital was one of only a few hospitals to treat poor African Americans. As medical records show, Ms. Lacks began undergoing radium treatment for her cervical cancer. This was the best medical treatment available at the time for this terrible disease. A sample of her cancer cells retrieved during a biopsy were sent to Dr. George Gay's nearby tissue lab. For years, Dr. Gay, a prominent cancer and virus researcher, had been collecting cells from all patients who came to the Johns Hopkins Hospital with cervical cancer. But each sample quickly died in Dr. Gray's lab. What he soon would discover was that Mrs. Lack's cells were unlike any of the others he had ever seen. While other cells would die, Mrs. Lack's cells doubled every 20 to 24 hours. Let me read that again. Her cells were unlike any others that he had ever seen. Other cells would die. Mrs. Lack's cells doubled every 20 to 24 hours. Today, these incredible cells, nicknamed HeLa cells, from the first two letters of her first and last names, are used to study the effects of toxins, drugs, hormones, and viruses on the growth of cancer cells without experimenting on humans. They have been used to test the effects of radiation and poisons, to study the human genome, to learn more about how viruses work, and played a crucial role in the development of the polio vaccine as well. Although Ms. Lacks ultimately passed away on October 4th, 1951, at the age of 31, her cells continued to impact the world. So we honor the great Henrietta Lacks. And her story was so magnetic that Oprah Winfrey, of course, did the movie on her life. So just a wonderful contribution to humanity, Henrietta Lacks. The immortal Henrietta Lacks, because of her cells, they live on after her, helping to treat diseases and provide, hopefully, a cure for many diseases as well. So Henrietta Lacks, a giant in her own right. All right, so as we get to local, state, and federal news, let's start locally. And before I get into the deconsolidation issue, let me talk about and let me give a shout out to those of you who have shown up to the many meetings held by the councilman about these deconsolidation. You guys have did a great civic duty to not only yourselves, your families, and the community, but just showing how impactful people can be. Many people have spoken to me about it. This will touch one and all, and many of you are speaking about it and speaking about the impact. What does it mean for us? Are we gonna pay higher taxes? Are we gonna have the same level of representation? okay, our district's going to be redrawn where our council district, District 3 or 4, will be weakened, okay, where the economic vitality will be sliced and diced. We hear, of course, when the maps are redrawn, some of the District 3's downtown area may be removed. So it's going to be a process there as well. But I want to really honor you guys and give you credit for coming out and really speaking to the issue. Now, let me say something to the council. Of course, the big vote is this Tuesday. When you come to the council, you would think that there would be an attitude of expression of joy that so many people are in the audience and want to speak and want to express themselves and want to inform us, we the councilmen. You would think that they would have that mindset, that viewpoint. But that's not the atmosphere that I perceive. I could be wrong, but that's not the atmosphere. We see people come up and they speak, and we see some councilmen with glazed eyes, which is better than what used to happen 20 years ago. I've been watching this council for over 30 years, but 20 years ago, you would have councilmen get up and walk away when there's something that they didn't want to hear. But one of the things that I find irritating now is that you're almost told what you can say. It's like, well, we're talking about this issue, and we don't want to hear anything other than that issue, anything that doesn't pertain to the issue at hand. Well, some of the things that you are talking about that you don't want to be muzzled and should not be muzzled for your 5 minutes is information, prior information, that would give a direct impact or more cogent viewpoint on what it is that you're discussing. For instance, if you're talking about consolidation, you will need to go back over 20 years, and you will need to talk about certain entities who were at the forefront in pushing one way or another, and some of the other issues involved, corporate issues involved, and gerrymandering and so forth that has been talked about. You will need to speak about that. You're not trying to be negative. You're trying to speak to the issue so you can inform and have a fuller understanding of it, instead of basically individuals having the mindset that, you know, I would give you your opinion and I would give you 5 minutes to express your given opinion. So, and I know it's not that severe yet, but if you drop in and just listen for a brief time, you could be forgiven for thinking that that is the way the council operates with the 5 minutes that you are given. So I know they'll do better this coming Tuesday. They will have a lot of people speaking. I know they will be respectful with what is said, because again, you may not like what the constituents are saying. You may not like the constituents' opinion, but it's the constituents' opinion. And they have a right in this still democracy, you know, this democratic republic we have, which we refer to as a democracy, most of us, we still have the right to say what's on our mind, to express our opinion. My grandmother, one of the reasons I vote, and the biggest reasons, is that I saw her walk miles to a cotton gin, which is the voting precinct in the country town of Columbia, where we grew up in the 1960s and 1970s, and she was proud to vote. And she would always tell the family, you know, I have a right to go down to the courthouse, which is our version of Columbia's version of City Hall in the 1960s and 70s. She would say, I have a right to go to the courthouse and speak my mind, okay? Because she voted. She never missed an election. And as most of you know, African Americans could not vote in large percentages until the 1960s. 1964 Voting Act was passed. Prior to that, if you tried to vote, you were given a jelly bean test, you were given a constitutional test, they would give you literature to read, you would have jelly beans, how many jelly beans are in this bottle, you would have the Klan doing military marching, you know, you would have houses bombed, you would have verbal threats, phone threats, you would have all type of intimidation. But when she was able to vote, and many others in the South were able to vote, they actively pursued the vote. And so they felt that they had a voice at that ballot box and even in the courthouse in her case in Columbia, Louisiana, Caldwell Parish in the 60s and 70s, had a voice to speak. So it's very important to me and many others, the voice, okay? And I never miss an election if I can help it. And I always try to early vote so my vote will indeed count. And we have seen in this parish where three votes have determined a school board member. Our current Cajun Dome director, three votes. And we have seen national elections where our current president, he won Michigan, two votes per ballot box in Michigan. It was that close, okay? Two votes per ballot box. Think of the many people who didn't go to vote, okay? Who could have made a difference one way or the other. So it is important to vote. And I was speaking to a friend, one of my childhood friends this evening. He talked about having a show devoted to voting, which we have had many over the 24 years I've been here. And many of the councilmen and even state legislators have come on, and national authors have come on and talked about voting and talked about voting rights and talked about what the African-American community went through to be able to vote. It's quite a travail that they had to undergo if they want to exercise their civic duty and really human rights as as people, as humans, equal humans. They had to go through quite a lot in order to exercise that voting right. So it's important. So it's not too late to register. And we always have a low voting count in off year elections, but I want you to make this the strongest election. And we talk about how low the voting percentages are, but what amazes me is the fact that you're talking about the people who are signed up. There are many, many more who could vote, who could be signed up, who are not on the voting rolls. And a psychologist friend of mine was talking about Belgium, and I referenced Australia to her. And what happens in Belgium and Australia, if you're a citizen and you refuse to vote, it's treated like a misdemeanor. You are fined, you know, and I believe up to $500 in Australia. And in Belgium, you have a similar fine. So it's treated as a misdemeanor, okay? Like a traffic citation if you don't exercise your voting rights. So, and that has been proposed by some that has never gained traction. But imagine if it does gain traction and you are mandated to vote as a citizen. Your civic right, your civic duty is mandated. And if you don't avail yourself, then you will be fined, you know, $300, $400, $500. Do we think that that would stimulate the voting some? I know many people say we shouldn't want to force people to vote. It's a right. If they don't want to vote, they shouldn't be compelled to vote. But we're looking at democracy here. So maybe Belgium and Australia has it right. Maybe it's something to look at. That certainly will be an ongoing argument and is an ongoing argument. How do we increase voting? We've talked about putting it on multiple days, talked about early voting, of course, and on the day of a presidential election or a state election, instead of a Tuesday, you know, putting it on other days or multiple days, as I said. So these things are being talked about, dialogued about, and certainly we need to constantly push our neighbors, push our society to vote in larger percentages. All right. So talking about Tuesday, what's going to happen Tuesday? On Tuesday, deconsolidation will be voted on, and I'll read you a little section from The Advocate. The rumblings behind the scene, the ear-to-the-ground information, the whispers are that the council has the votes, six votes, to place the initiative on the ballot in December. And it would be a December 8th election. So the rumblings are that the votes are there. It's just a formality on Tuesday. But I want you to come and speak your mind, you know, as if everything's up in the air. You have a right to do that. So again, deconsolidation. Let's go back over 20 years ago when I was filming for this entity, AOC. I was filming city council meetings, parish council meetings, this is before consolidation, and school board meetings. So in the early 90s, one budget had the city at 280 million and the parish at 20 million. Let me say that again. The city of Lafayette had 280 million in its operating budget and the parish had 20 million. So that means that Lafayette had more than 10 times the revenues of Karen Crow, Scott, Doosan, Youngsville, and Broussard, okay? 280 million to 20 million. So a child can figure that out. Of course, the entities with 20 million, which is about what, 4 million per, you know, they're gonna wanna attach themselves to the city, attach themselves to that $280 million. All right, so the big issue, one of the big issues after consolidation passed, is that you had some of the outliers, if you will, particularly Youngsville's representative on the parish council, the city parish council, who constantly was against the appropriation of monies for projects, certain projects in Lafayette, okay? But it was strange when there was an initiative that, you know, funded a project in Youngsville, there was no such consternation. There was no such negativity. There was no such fight over sending funds and projects into Youngsville. But as it relates to Lafayette proper, oh, he had all kind of issues. And I think he's term limited out. Even if this initiative fails, he's term limited out. But the word on the street is that it looks as if, you know, they have the 6 votes. And right now, the percentages are pro deconsolidation. So the initiative may very well pass. Again, we had the argument over 20 years ago about consolidating. I was against it because, again, what happened indeed happened. It was entirely predictable, and we have seen it, and now we want to detach. We want to correct a mistake. All right, some of the issues, and we'll see what the advocate says about it, but some of the issues are that will, once, if the deconsolidation passes in December, will we have 2 minority districts? We have been told at some of these meetings by some of our councilmen that the first thing that is looked at is keeping minority districts, and they're looking to do that. But then another question becomes, because they have to roughly have the same percentages in each of the 5 districts, but the question becomes, how will you carve up the districts when you redraw the maps? Will some of the minority districts that have, for instance, downtown, some of the, and downtown is about to thrive, we have several businesses coming online, will that be cut out from District 3, cut out from the minority districts? So all of this is weighing in the balance as well, and it certainly will be discussed, I'm sure, about a citizenry and hopefully the council on Tuesday. So it's going to be a long meeting on Tuesday. Of course, we're starting a school. I'm in the school system, but I will try to drop by for some time to see what's occurring there to do my civic duty. All right, so the article. Council poised to decide on calling it splits. That's in today's Acadiana Advocate. The Lafayette City Parish Council is slated to vote Tuesday on a series of amendments to the Home Rule Charter that would split the council into 2 separate bodies pending voter approval. The council voted on July 10th to introduce amendments that would create 2 5-member councils, one to represent the city of Lafayette and the other to represent the parish, while the mayor president's office would remain consolidated. Tuesday's council vote will determine if the charter amendments will be presented to the voters at an election on December 8th. And again, word on the street, Behind the scenes information is that they have the votes to send it to the December 8th election. All right, the amendments were prompted by changes that have occurred since the city and parish governments consolidated in 1996. Councilman Bruce Conk said, pointing to the shrinking population inside Lafayette city limits, while neighboring communities like Broussard and Youngsville are booming. So one of the issues is that with the 2020 census, the thought is that the five parish seats will have more representation, more population than Lafayette. We consolidated back in 1996, says Conk. There were a lot of hopes and desires that never actually materialized. There was an intent from the get-go. This is Councilman Conk speaking. Perhaps we can combine the revenue sources, which would address the parish side and their financial crises. This never changed. So what was intended and what was hoped for never materialized. According to Conk, if this split were to occur, it would be a unique outlier in American politics, as local governments normally and typically don't vote to split apart after having gone through the consolidation process. From what I've been told, experts in this field say this will be a unique move on the part of a consolidated government. They cannot cite any other instance of this happening. It's going to have a ripple effect, I think. Conk said, as far back as we are concerned, it just goes to the basic right of every municipality to gain control of its own governing process in terms of legislative body. He also said he was surprised by the resentment he saw in the town halls from those who live outside the city for those who live within city limits. And we have constantly heard that from other city residents as well. The proposal itself has not been seen by most as too controversial, but the majority of those who oppose it seem to be against the perceived rush nature of the amendments. And quite frankly, we heard a councilman and several councilmen say that they didn't think it had been rushed. But quite frankly, let's level, guys. It has been rushed, okay? This could have been, instead of June and July, it could have been January and February. And you could have had a series of town hall meetings spread across weeks, not just a five-day period, but spread across weeks where people could digest the pros and cons of the consolidations more easily. But what we did, we rushed it in the summer, and this is what we have. So I think it has been rushed somewhat. All right, to slow things down and allow for council members to discuss the possible changes with constituents, the vote was pushed back and town halls were held across Lafayette Parish last month. So yes, the public, there was a little outcry in this process being a little hasty, a little bit rushed, or more than a little bit rushed. So things were kind of halted somewhat. And we had more information in the town hall meetings. Some opponents also saw a few flaws in the original proposal, most notably how the new district maps were drawn up for majority-minority districts and potential loophole in the parish term limits for council members that would have allowed for term-limited members of the current council to run for re-election on the new council. Now, many of you are not for term limits. Some of you are. We talk about career politicians that are sitting in there doing nothing. The other argument about that is that if you have been in there a long time, it takes a while to get the understanding, the experience, to know how to wield the power for good, to know how all different branches of local and parish government works so you can be effective. So by the time you become effective, you are cast out by term limits. And if you have been effective, why not continue to allow the councilman to be effective? That's one argument. Again, the other argument, you're a political sitter. You're in office and you're just planning to stay in office as long as you can. And we need new blood after a certain period of time. A friend of mine from the military, that's his opinion. And he talked about in the military where you are moved from bases every 2 to 3 years. You are given different orders because you lose your effectiveness and new commanders are brought in and you are sent elsewhere. And typically commanders, you know, 3 or 4 years, and they're sent elsewhere, at least in my experience, my 24 years in the Air Force. So he was talking to me, he comes from the Army, my friend. He was talking to me about that. If commanders in the military are moved because they don't want them to be become ineffective, why shouldn't that relate to politics? And many of the commanders who have been moved were great commanders. They got great ratings, okay? They passed inspections, top rated. Okay, so they didn't really, in my opinion, need to be moved. But the process was that we don't want to get stale, so we will remove, give our commanders different commands and move them after a certain period of time. All right, but you may have a different viewpoint. You say, hey, if my councilman has been doing a great job, I want to keep voting for him on into the future. I don't want a 12-year limit. So there's a lot of debate and discussion on that matter. No right or wrong, it's just a debate, it's your viewpoint. All right, however, revisions were released last week that addressed some of the issues. The city's two majority minority districts represented by Councilman Kenneth Boudreau, who is District 4's councilman, and he's my council representative as well, a fine gentleman, he's very knowledgeable, as is District 3, Mr. Lewis, who is very knowledgeable, and also he works well with his constituents. And if you need something done and you call him, he will get back to you. He doesn't brush you off. So many people, he's very popular. Many people love him because of that. So two very popular councilmen, Kenneth Boudreau and Pat Lewis, very helpful, very popular councilmen. All right. They were originally going to be drawn up with, let me read that again. The council two majority minority districts represented by Councilman Kenneth Boudreau and Pat Lewis were originally going to be drawn up with Boudreau's district having a makeup of nearly 75% minority representation, while Lewis's would have had barely over 51%. The new maps have both districts at just over 60%. So districts 3 and 4, just over 60%. On the maps with districts 3 and 4. The Acadiana Advocate was unable to reach Boudreau Lewis for comment on those changes. This is again reported in today's Acadiana Advocate. The issue of term limits was partially addressed by adding that term limited members of the previous council could not run for the new council. However, it still leaves open the possibility that council members who hadn't been term limited out of their seat would have their number of terms reset on the new council. Councilwoman Nanette Cook and Liz Hebert have said they will introduce a term rollover provision, which they can do from the floor on Tuesday before the vote. One of the proposed charter amendments would require city voters to approve any contracts with outside entities to manage from the Lafayette utility system. So again, one of the proposed charter amendments would require city voters, to approve any contracts with outside entities to manage the Lafayette utilities system. So it would require the voters to say yay or no or nay on a private company running the Lafayette utility system. And as we know, there's been some discussion vis-a-vis the city parish president on that, all right, with a private entity. All right, Lewis, along with Councilman William Terrio and Jared Bellard, were the three who opposed the amendments coming to a vote. Those following the vote are also watching for signs from Lewis on his proposed proportional voting alternative. Instead of splitting City Parish Council, Lewis's alternative would weigh the current council's votes on issues based on the makeup of the district each council member represents, okay? So city members vote on city matters, and a way to have the city represented more robustly in the current format. All right, if the council would be voting on an issue that primarily affects the city and not the rural areas of the parish, A district completely in the city will get a full vote, while a district that only represents 10% of the city will get 1/10 of a vote. Votes would be dedicated by a final score. So this will get a little bit complicated, but we have the accountants and we have the mathematical minds to deal with it. So it is a workable solution if they chose to go that route. It is workable. When I hear people say this is too complicated, it's going to take too long, there have been many more complicated things that have been proposed, passed, and have worked than this proportional voting. So proportional voting, should they decide to go that route, is indeed workable. All right, Boudreaux has openly stated his opposition to the plan, saying it is unfair to city residents who live in majority non-city districts. Proportional voting is a nice thing for members of the body, but it's not a very nice thing for the people, according to Boudreaux. The Acadiana advocate reached out to Councilman Lewis on if he was be proposing his proportional voting plan Tuesday, but did not receive a response in time for the article. The council will meet at 5:30 Tuesday at the Ted A. Art Wayne City Parish Council Auditorium, 705 West University Avenue. If the measure passes, once again, it will go before voters on December 8th. The new system will take effect on in 2020. So this is a very, very serious issue, deconsolidation, and you guys have taken it very, very seriously, and I applaud you for doing so. So we'll see you on Tuesday again in the school system, but I will try to drop by and see what the final decision is on deconsolidation, a big choice that the council has to make and a big choice that we have to make in December of this year. All right, I want to go over just briefly some legislative highlights, some issues that have passed at the state level. All right, Senate Bill 160, Act 148 prohibits tying or tethering a dog or cat in a designated emergency area during a flood or hurricane. And we saw many such animals. I heard many stories of that during recent hurricanes. So Senate Bill 160 will prevent that. Also, there's a bill that if a dog or a child is in a locked vehicle in a parking lot, a parent has forgot their child, you can break the window and free them without any charges. So that is a good bill, because the temperature inside a vehicle can get up to well over 100, you know, 120, 130 degrees or more on a 95 or 100 degree day, and you have the windows up, you're in direct sunlight, and it can just get unbearably hot, and young children and animals can suffer grave harm. So that's important to have that bill. All right, on elections, House Bill 265, Act 636, allows a convicted felon who is under an order of imprisonment to register and vote if the person has not been incarcerated within the last 5 years. It is so important to get across the nation to give voting rights back to the incarcerated, working on that. You should not be permanently disenfranchised from your civic right to vote because of incarceration. You have paid your penalty, and your penalty is being locked up, deprivation of your freedom. Your penalty is not having your voting rights stripped from you permanently. That is not just. So this House Bill 265, Act 636 will go a long way toward providing justice in that area. All right, the military and veterans. All right, Senate Bill 548, Act 251, creates a pretrial diversion program for veterans diagnosed with post-traumatic stress disorder. And that is so important, because we have many veterans who have PTSD as a result of prolonged services in Afghanistan and Iraq, as you read and heard on many news programs. We had four, five, six deployments almost consecutively with many soldiers. That cannot help but in a war zone cause post-traumatic stress disorder. All right, another bill, House Bill 446, Act 637, creates penalties for the failure to seek medical assistance when reckless behavior results in serious bodily injury. Senate Bill 91, Act 481, authorizes exemplary damages when a person's death was caused by an act of hazing, regardless of whether the defendant was prosecuted. And of course, LSU and even here at UL, we've had fraternities have had their charter temporarily suspended due to hazing, okay? Due to hazing. And we've seen across the nation several individuals who have been killed because of hazing over the last several years, hazing incidents. So it's time for a law of this type to address that concern. All right, Senate Bill 178, and this deals with education. Act 523 allows bulletproof backpacks in K through 12 and post-secondary institutions. It is very sad that we had to get to that level whereby we need bulletproof backpacks, and that is even considered in our schools, but that has been considered and passed. So in the schools, you will see students with funny-looking backpacks, odd-looking backpacks, and those are the bulletproof backpacks that the bill allows. And it's sad in our society, in our schools, that we have to go to that extent, but maybe we have to go to that extent to protect our children. Bulletproof backpacks, and you know, you might say, what's next, bulletproof clothing, but you know, we're doing what is necessary to protect the students. And of course, you know, a resource officer is in every school. So I applaud that endeavor. Safety is of paramount importance for our children, for our students, and for our society. Now, in the remaining 8 minutes, I believe we have, I want to talk a little bit about national news. And something that I frequently talk to you and the community about, and my retired friend from the Army, a Sergeant Major, and other individuals from North Louisiana. And that is about our president and his actions, okay? The individual who occupies the presidency, because he doesn't really, in my opinion, see himself as the president of all Americans. But he is in that office. I have a friend who refers to him as 45th or 45, you know. He doesn't refer to him as the president. He refers to him as 45. And I can see where he's coming from, because you have a president who chooses to incite crowds, who in one crowd, as you saw during the campaign, an African-American was punched in the face, and a president who says he would like to punch people in the face, and who calls the press the enemy of the people, okay? Who calls the Russian penetration of our elections, what, fake news, a witch hunt? This Russian witch hunt is fake news. When his intelligence apparatus, and of course, they came out, his DNI, Coates, Director of National Intelligence, the FBI, Mr. Ray, and several others came out and essentially said, from my point of view, that they would go on their own and they will protect the nation and harden our electoral process. Yes, caller, go ahead.
How you doing, John?
Doing well.
Hey, listen, we probably got about 6-7 minutes and I'm having trouble hearing on my cell phone. So I'm gonna make a couple quick comments and questions. Then I'm gonna hang up and get your thoughts.
Okay.
One thing is, my first comment is about the criminal justice system. Paul Manafort facing over 300 years in prison for some, you know, financial crimes. Yeah, you had the African, I think her name was Mary Alice Stewart, you know what I'm talking about, the one Donald Trump pardoned.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to believe. How can any prosecutor, I'm gonna say this one. Remember, I should say, but I'm gonna say it anyway. The prosecutor and the judge should have both been shot. How can you sentence any person?
And you're talking figuratively. He doesn't mean shot. He means figuratively. Right, yeah. Go ahead, though.
Right. But anyway, how can you sentence a first-time drug offender woman to life imprisonment, and she spent 20 years in prison? Are you kidding me?
I agree.
Especially given the fact that this punk Seth Fontenot shot a friend of mine's son, killed him off the river at 15 years old a couple of years back, shot into a vehicle. Listen, people, this punk, this low-life punk, I'd like to get my hands on him, spent 13 months in jail. I'm going to say it again. 13 months, and he took a life. Now, one more question I'm going to hang up. You can answer this.
Okay.
I'm not the smartest person, but I'm not the dumbest person. How can you have a parish president, a parish council, but Broussard, Scott, Cam, Crew, Young Gill, all have a separate mayor? Keep up the good work, John. I'll talk to you later. Thank you, man.
Thank you. The caller made a couple of great points. The young lady he was talking about, I believe she was from Mississippi, first time drug offense, and she was essentially given a life sentence. She was pardoned. The mandatory minimums that Ronald Reagan and Bill Clinton as well, which is one of the reasons his wife was unpopular with many in the community. These mandatory minimums. You saw a swelling of the prison ranks under Ronald Reagan and under Bill Clinton, okay? It was just amazing. So that called out for reformation. And Kim Kardashian was able to prevail upon our 45th president to get a pardon for this lady who was given a much too lengthy sentence, a life sentence, I believe, and she was pardoned. By the current president. So we do have some injustices here within the nation. And, you know, we have to, like Ron Dellums, U.S. Representative, former U.S. Representative Ron Dellums, you have to keep fighting. These issues are not going away. And I want to make one more mention. I'm going to let my caller, and he's going to be brief because I have one more thing to mention. But go ahead, caller. Yes, go ahead, caller. Caller? All right, so we lost the caller. I want to make one more mention of the current president and what we should be doing, in my opinion. Now, again, you don't have to take my viewpoint, but I'll just state it here as we run out of time. Your president is basically saying that the penetration of our electoral system did not happen. His intelligence apparatus would go on, as they did this past week, go on television and say we were penetrated. Congress says we were penetrated. Our electoral system was affected by Russian hacking. The president of Russia directed it. There's evidence to that. And what happened? You have the president still saying it's fake news. Houston, I have a problem with that, okay? So let me just roll out, and I know we have some callers waiting, but I need to roll this out as to what we should be doing as a people, in my opinion. Instead of sitting by, how about calling your U.S. senator, as I have went by his office? You can call, or you can fax, or you can go by John Kennedy and Bill Cassidy's office here. You know, you pass over the bridge by the Hilton, make that left turn, you go all the way down that glass building, and you can go and talk in person to their staff, and you can let them know how you feel about this Russia situation, cozying up to Russia. You can do that. Okay? And you should do that. It is that important. Okay? Because when the investigation ends and when Congress has to do what they have to do based on the information that will be presented of Russian interference, there's no way you can ignore it. So we cannot sit around and stand around as if nothing is happening. Republicans and moderates and even Democrats often reference Ronald Reagan and speak about him in revered tones. They love Ronald Reagan, right? Ronald Reagan, although I didn't agree with all of his policies, and maybe most of his policies, was a patriot, okay? Tear down this wall, Mr. Gorbachev. He was a patriot. Although he had wrong-headed right-wing policies, he was a patriot. And so I can respect a patriot. Donald Trump is not a patriot. Unfortunately, we have the 45th president of the United States who I can say, by his actions, is not a patriot, okay? There's nothing that he has been doing that is patriotic. So it is incumbent upon you and I not to give this guy aid and comfort. So he says after Labor Day, he's gonna be out there on the road.